spot for the Lord.
You've been so good to me.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you to the angel voices. God, I just thank you that in you there is freedom. So God, would you just be continuing to speak to our hearts as Mikey brings the word? That we would find freedom as your word washing over us. That it wouldn't just be a Saturday night where we're just hearing a message of hope. That your word would resonate into our hearts, God, and transform us into new creations. I'll do some announcements from here. My name is Jessica. For those of you that don't know me, I'm the worship leader here. And tonight we've got a special speaker, Mikey Metcalf. And so for those of you that don't know, both he and I also, we went through the Hope for Freedom house many years ago at the same time. So it's exciting that he is going to share a word. I'm just going to pray for him quickly before he ends. Father God, we're just so grateful for the work that you've done in this place, God. So we just lift up Mikey right now as he brings the word, God. That it would just be what you have for us tonight, God. That Mikey would just be confident in his proclaiming and sharing your goodness, Jesus. It's just such a blessing to have somebody that you've raised up, God, into a godly man bringing the word to us, Lord. It's just exciting. So we're so excited for what you have to us, and we just pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
I like that really loud. The part where it's hallelujah, I'm free. That really pretty good because I actually be free in my life right now. I've never really experienced it before. I've been for about 5 years. Before that I was pretty messed up and I was it was pretty stressed. Life was pretty tough. But it's great, and dear Lord, I would like to pray that everyone gets the experience of the freedom that I have to you. I pray that everyone has that experience. My recovery goes well and get to go home and rebuild all the stuff. Okay, hi everyone, my name is Mikey. I think most of you know me now, but for those who don't, my wife and I went to Hope for Freedom in 2016. Our life has been phenomenally transferred to Jesus, and our relationship with Northridge in the last few years, and I hope everyone gets free. The message today is out of Matthew. There's a lot of wisdom here. Communication is interpersonal relationship. Very difficult. Let's get started. Matthew 18, 1-5 reads. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and said, "Who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" Called a child to him, and placed the child among them. He said, "Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. Now, in current society, a child is not a lowly position, but we must remember that in the time of Jesus, children were treated a lot differently. A child is not of great importance in society. Not threatening, not good at discussion, humble, and not concerned with social justice. The disciples are here asking who is the greatest, telling them. It is basically the person with the lowest social. He didn't say the king of Egypt is the greatest, or the owner of the biggest church. Those things don't matter to you. He's telling the disciples to let go of all their ideals of what they thought was the greatest, and not even focus within. This is important for us to learn in recovery because we may have thought we were so cool with lots of money or a reputation, but the reality is that in the grand scheme of things, that means nothing. Anyone causes one of these little ones, those who believe me, to stumble, it would be better for them to have a large rock hung around their neck for the hundreds of death. Woe for the world because of the things that cause them to stumble. Such things must come, but woe to the person through who they come. If your hand or foot causes you to stumble, cut it off and throw it away. It's better for you to enter life maimed or crippled than to have two hands or feet thrown into the fire. And if your eyes cause you to stumble, gouge it out. Throw it away. It's better for you to enter life with one eye than to have two eyes thrown in the fire. When Jesus says little ones here, he doesn't necessarily mean children. He's referring to Christ's followers. We are reborn. We are reborn into children of God after accepting Jesus into our hearts. If you are causing someone to sin, initiating a pattern of sin in someone else's life, you might as well destroy yourself. That's what Jesus thinks about that. Now, aside from causing someone else's sin, what about yourself? Jesus says that if your foot causes you to sin, then you should cut it off because it's better to no foot into your afterlife. We can apply this principle less extremely in our daily lives to improve them. Is your phone distracting you from more important tasks? Lock it away until you're done. Is the toxic person in your life in the way of your recovery? Cut them out of your life. This is a surefire way to keep on track without judgment. See that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I tell you that the angels in heaven always. What do you think if a man owns 100 sheep and one of them wanders away, will he leave the 99 on the hill and go look for the others that wandered up? And if he finds it, truly, I tell you, he's happier than the one sheep, happier about the one sheep than about the 99 that didn't wander. In the same way, your Father in heaven is not willing that any of these little ones to go. Highlighting here how important we are. We can't compare ourselves to the sheep that wandered off. No matter how many times we stray from our path, God is there waiting to welcome us back into His arms. I can picture the rejoicing in heaven of someone who has been living in darkness finding their way into God's light. We must protect ourselves and others at all costs from falling back into darkness. Matthew 18:15-20. If your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault. Just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two others along so that every matter can be established by the testimony of two or three. If they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen, even to the church, treat them as you would a heathen or a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about something they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three gather in my name, there am I with them. This part is straightforward, but not easy to understand in our daily life. You see someone doing something wrong, calling out on it, hard part is finding the courage to ask for backup from others. But if you think about it, we do it with kids, so why not each other? The teacher sees a child misbehaving in school, they will talk to them. If that doesn't work, they'll involve the principal. If that doesn't work, they'll involve the principal. The same approach of problem-solving hierarchy occurs in workplaces too. It may be awkward to confront your friend, but you may not do it to avoid conversation or not to embarrass them. We need to normalize hard conversations as people. If you aren't willing to address concerns, you aren't helping. Confronting problems head-on can save lives and recovery. Now on to Matthew 18, 21 to 35. And Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister? Up to 7 times? Jesus answered, I tell you, not 7 times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. He was not able to pay them enough to order that he and his wife and children, all that they owned, be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient, he begged, and I will pay back everything. The servant answered with pity on him. But when that servant went out, he found another servant who owed him 100 coins. He grabbed him and began to choke him. He paid me back with the clothes. The fellow servant begged him, be patient with me, please, I will pay you back. But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, cancel that debt of yours that you made. Wouldn't you have had the same mercy on your fellow as I did on him? Anger the master. This is how my heavenly Father would treat each of you. Forgive your brother or sister from your heart. This is an important parable thing because it highlights how important forgiveness is. Forgiveness is essential to our success in life. More so in our recovery. We are forgiven. All our sins are washed away as soon as we accept. So who are we to go around carrying judgment? If we have been completely forgiven, we can bestow that upon others as well. Resentment is a horrible thing. It's like drinking poison and expecting a worse thing. We can never get anywhere or improve our life from carrying grief and hate. Doesn't mean being a pushover mental location. Advantage of you? You must understand that only you can control your feelings and choosing to come out of the secret, you end up giving yourself. Thank you guys for listening. And that's all that. And we're gonna David will come up and pray. The sinner's prayer is tied in. I just want to say I got a lot of respect for you guys, man. The voice you guys need to be going to know is a hard choice. But it's so rewarding, man. I couldn't even imagine. So, I don't know, when you guys went to homeless, it was like horrible. I didn't think it could have been, but you get to wake up every day in the house. So, hey. Anyways, I hope, I pray, and I hope everyone gets it.
Mike, you put me on the spot telling me I'm going to pray, but that's good. That's good. I'm really thankful for Mike. Actually, you said something early days that's really stuck with me about the way you did recovery. And you talked about how you kind of had eyes on somebody who was a little bit ahead of you in recovery. And you really gave that as strong advice to people, especially early days. Look for people who are just a couple of steps ahead of you. And it's a good life lesson, right? Like, if you want to be a carpenter, find somebody who's a good carpenter. Well, Dr. Mikey there too. But find somebody who does that well and keep your eyes on them. And they're going to be imperfect, but they'll help you get where you want to go. And so I thought it was really, it's like years ago now you said that, but it really stuck with me. Something else I want to point out that you taught on today, I just thought was perfect tie-in to what you led us, Jessica, that song, that Reckless Love song. And in Matthew 18, it talks about that Jesus leaving the 99 to pursue the one. And again, I've walked with Mikey for a long time, and I know he's kind of really owned his past. And I'm sure there are times when he's like, why would God care about me, especially when you're at your lowest, right? Why would he care? And yet he pursues us at our worst moments with just this, like, aggressive love for us. And I think it's so beautiful. So anyways, thank you very much. I got so much love and respect for Mikey, and I don't know if you guys realize this, but he's very well married to Freya, who's at the back now covering for my world back there. And they partner really well with this. I was actually just saying to Mikey that this is my wife, by the way, Carolee. I think I introduced her a couple weeks ago. Now you can clap for her. I clap for her like every day. This is over. But Carolee and I love her very much. But we don't do ministry things. There's a lot of things we don't do well together. We just think differently, and we really enjoy premarital counseling. But that's about the only thing that we do well together. But Mikey and Freya work very closely when preparing messages like this, and it's very cool, and I love it. So I actually wasn't called up to talk. Let's pray and walk into another time of worship. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. And Father, we love the story that you're telling in Mikey and Freya and Scarlet Master's life. We love the story that you're telling each one of our lives. The stuff that's happened in the past, some of the good stuff, some of the bad stuff. But the hope that you can offer us for a good future, that the hope that we can have when we follow you, when our eyes are on you. And so, Father, I pray tonight that we would walk away with this word in our hearts, that through your Holy Spirit you would take what Mikey's taught us, take your word that you gave us, and put them in a blender, and that we would walk out of here transformed differently than the way we came in. We would have something new from you that we could take with us in the days ahead. Lord, bless these guys, and bless us as we sing the song to you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's stand and worship.
You breathe your life in me. You've been so.
only person standing in this room. You're the only person on earth that you would come for us. So, we just love you, Jesus. We just thank you for becoming a man, for becoming a person like us, God. You're such a good God. So please be blessed as you leave from here and know that God would come and kick down the door for you. Love. Sweet love.